إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلواته ربي وسلامه عليه أما بعد and بفضل الله عز وجل علينا ومنه وكرمه سبحانه we find ourselves being he subhanahu wa ta'ala al-mawla upon the doorstep of this tremendous mawsim that is ahead of us, this occasion and this event, which is the month of Ramadan. And we want to share, barakallahu fikum, with our brothers, hafidhakum Allahu ta'ala wa wafakakum ila ma yuhibu wa yarda, something from the mention of the condition of the salaf, of our pious predecessors, and how they welcomed the month of Ramadan bi-idhnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. And like we become accustomed to, inshaAllah ta'ala, there shall be a series of bullet points, inshaAllah ta'ala, that you can make notes from. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala al-mawla. And the first one is exactly that, is that the mawasim of Allah azza wa jal, min rahmatihi, they come one after another. That the occasions where the righteous deeds are multiplied come one after another. And if we were to look upon this occasion that is upon us, bi-idhnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the month of Ramadan, then one would notice that it should be a means, bi-idhnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala, of purification and rectification. And then is followed by the occasion of Eid and what that contains of benefit and worship. And then after that is the 6 days of Shawwal. The one is to fast, having completed Ramadan, and he follows it up with 6 days. They'll be recorded for him as if he fasted the entire year. So he granted us subhanahu wa ta'ala such occasion where he multiplied that in the good deeds in order to encourage us, in order to be a source of rectification and a time of reflection and muhasaba, that we bring ourselves to account. Then shortly after that occasion, we find ourselves bi-idhnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala al-mawla in the months of Hajj. And in this regard, barakallahu fikum, one should not allow these occasions to come and go just like that. Though we should truly yani benefit from them in the best of manner. And point number two, مَا أَنْتَ إِلَّا أَيَّامٍ, that we are nothing as nothing more than allotted days. And this was certainly the statement of Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala. And he stated, مَا أَنْتَ إِلَّا أَيَّامٍ كُلُّ مَا مَضَى يَوْمٍ مَضَى بَعْدُكَ, that you are nothing other than a series of days that has been allotted to you. Every single day that passes, part of you passes by and goes. وَكُلُّ مَا مَضَى يَوْمٍ اِقْتَرَبْتَ إِلَىٰ أَجَلِكَ, and every single time a day passes, you have in reality only come closer to your allotted time, when all of this will come to an end, when we will return back to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once we realize this, it puts everything into perspective bi-idhnihi subhanahu, that we cannot allow such occasion to come to us except that we take the fullest of means in benefiting from it, and that we return back to Allah azza wa jal. And wallahi, all of us are oppressors who've oppressed ourselves and oppressed our souls, and we're in need of such occasions to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Salaf, they would say likewise, طُوبَى لِمَنْ أَصْلَحَ نَفْسَهُ قَبْلَ رَمَضَانَ, that's successful and give glad tidings of paradise to the one who rectified himself even before Ramadan came, بِإِذْنِهِ subhanahu wa ta'ala. And point number three, مَا هَذَا الدَّارِ إِلَّا دَارِ الْإِمْتِحَانِ وَالْبَلَىٰ وَسَعِيدُ مَنْ يَعْبُدَ اللَّهِ, that this worldly life that we're in is nothing other than a place of test and trial and tribulation. And successful is he who worships Allah in it. So if we were to understand that the real purpose of us being here in this worldly life, it was not mere play. Neither was it that we just live without purpose in jest. Rather, he created us subhanahu wa ta'ala لِحِكْمَةٍ عَظِيمَةٍ وَغَايَةٌ نَبِيرَةٍ, and it's nothing other than that we worship him subhanahu. And he stated, جَلَّ جَلَالُ وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, that he has not created mankind nor the jinn for any other purpose other than to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this again, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, should anchor the importance of our worldly life and what it contains. And it should really recenter us and focus us bi-idhnihi subhanahu. And it should be a means for us to race and hasten towards those righteous good deeds in that which will be, inshaAllah ta'ala, multiplied by his permission at such a time. Because there are two types of people when Ramadan comes. The one, first of all, that was happy and he saw it as an opportunity to be successful and to enter into a business transaction with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, selling himself, his desires and his wants, both that which is physical and that which is spiritual. And he did not break his fast, and he sought nearness to Allah. And the second type of person, when Ramadan comes, He's the one that in reality is not increased in anything other than distance. He spends his nights perhaps eating and drinking in ghafla. Or even worse, he's not just merely in a state of heedlessness. He's in a state of sin and transgression against himself. Unable to benefit from its nights. And perhaps he sleeps throughout his day. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. Such a person is not increased except in distance from his Lord subhanahu. And without a shadow of a doubt, he is the one who has oppressed himself. And he does not harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the least. Neither does the one who worships him subhanahu, because he is ghaniyun hamid. Because he is the all self-sufficient subhanahu wa ta'ala, not in need of his creation, the one deserving of praise subhanahu. And this should cause us to have certainty, bi'ithinlahi ta'ala, of such a month that is upon us on such occasion. And it is reported authentically from our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from that which should serve as an encouragement for the doer of good. And it should serve as a warning for the one who intended what he intended from evil. As it was stated that a caller has called out, will call out, Ya baghir khayr aqbil, wa ya baghir shar aqsir. That the caller will call out, O you who wants to do good, come forth and do good, because it is here for you to take, bi'ithnihi subhanah. And O one who wants to sin and oppress himself and continue upon the path of destruction that he's upon, and he desires evil, stop where you are in your tracks. And Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned to us the purpose of this month. He said, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykumus siyam, kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum, la'allakum tattaqoon. O you who believe, prescribed for you is fasting, the same way it was prescribed for the previous nations before you. And he mentioned the purpose and the goal of this fast, in order that you may obtain taqwa. And point number four, min a'zami asbab at-taqwa, sawm Ramadan. That from the greatest means of obtaining the fear of Allah is what we find in the month of Ramadan. And we shall speak of bi'ithnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala, how the Salaf welcomed Ramadan, how they were concerning their fast, how they were concerning their standing in prayer, how they were with the recitation of the Quran, how they were over pondering over its meaning, how they were in this last 10 days, how they were concerning Laylatul Qadr, bi'ithnihi subhanahu, and how they were after Ramadan, insha'Allah ta'ala Rabbul Alameen. So the purpose of this month was to obtain the taqwa of Allah, to place between ourselves and the displeasure of Allah and His anger, may Allah save us from it, a barrier that would prevent us, bi'ithnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala, from falling into that which He dislikes, and that we rush and we hasten to His pleasure subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how can one not do so? When it is affirmed on the authority of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith al-Qudsi, what he narrates on the authority of his Lord Jalla Jalalu, who stated, Kullu amal ibn Adam lah, illa sawm fa innahu li wa ana ajazi bih. When it is our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala who specified and he stated that the action of Adam, all of it is for him, except for the fasting, because it belongs to me and solely me alone, and I am the one who recompenses for it and he rewards for it. What's intended here is not that Allah Azza wa Jalla does not reward for the other good deeds, no. Rather that there is a specific reward that he has left and that he's entrusted himself subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically when it came to the right of the fasting person, in a way that he has not done with any of the other righteous good deeds that the son of Adam performs. And you have to ask yourselves, if we have been entrusted and placed in the hands of Allah, Al-Jawadul Kareem, the most benevolent subhanahu wa ta'ala and kind and generous, then how can we not race and hasten to His reward subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He is the one that we know that multiplies the good deeds between 10 and 700. So what about the one who has entrusted himself subhanahu wa ta'ala to specifically reward the fasting person? And number five is the dhikr ba'ud fawaid hadha shahr, is the mention of some of the virtues of this tremendous month that is upon us bi'ithnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from them, like we know, is the khalufu fam as-sa'im atyab 'inda Allah min rih al-misk, That smell that emits from the mouth of a fasting person, that to be honest, at times is not the best of smell, is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than even the sweet smelling misk. And inside of this month, Tusaffad, fihi shayateen, that the shayateen, they are locked away. Oh, one that wanted to oppress himself and wanted to hasten to criminality. The shayateen have been locked up. Hold yourself back and return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hope in Him. And we know that inside of this month, the gates of Jannah have been opened. So hasten to rush through them. And the gates of the fire, bi'ithnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala, have been closed. So save yourselves from them. And we know that inside of these nights, bi'ithnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala, that are upon us, that He stated, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fi kulli laylatin min al-layalih, لله عز وجل فيه عتقاء من النار. Then every single night from these nights that are upon us, there are from His servant subhanahu wa ta'ala that He shall free and save from the fire. May Allah save us from it and never make us from its inhabitants to be saved in the first place. So for this reason, enter upon this month in a state of happiness and joy and bliss, seeking the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look at the condition of our blessed Salaf, of our predecessors, those that preceded us in every goodness. And the best of them was the one who stated, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to his daughter, Ni'ma Salaf ana laki, certainly I am the best of predecessor for you. And this is point number 6. The Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is our first and foremost Salaf. And we do not need to look far, bi'ithnihi subhanah, to see an example of a heart that feared Allah, to see an example of a man who feared Allah, to see the example of a person that took his zad, took his provision from worship. فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ زَادِ التَّقْوَى. And the best of provision that you can take upon this journey back to Allah is the fear of Allah itself. We do not need to look far, bi'ithnillahi ta'ala, to see the one that obtained the pleasure of Allah and that was pleased with Allah. We do not need to look far to see the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actualized. And this is the one, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whose deeds were accepted. And all of his sins, and aslan, he's from the Anbiya, he does not really commit sins, except the minor sin from that which in reality is nothing other than shortcoming. All of it was forgiven for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then looking at his seerah, looking how he lived, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the lives of his companion and those that were around him and those that were from their students, from our blessed Salaf, we shall have inshaAllah ta'ala a sufficient reminder and example to follow. And Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala commented upon the worship of the Messenger, and he stated, كَانَ مِنْ هَدِيهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فِي شَرِّ الرَّمَضَانِ الْإِكْثَارِ مِنْ أَنْوَاعِ الْعِبَادَاتِ. That he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, inside of the month of Ramadan, this is from his guidance and teaching and way, that he would, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, increase in various different types of worship. فَكَانَ جِبْرِيلَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ يُدَارِسُهُ الْقُرْآنِ فِي رَمَضَانِ. That Jibreel will sit with him and will teach him and will review the Qur'an with him in the month of Ramadan. وَكَانَ إِذَا لَقِيَهُ جِبْرِيلَ فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ. And every time he met Jibreel, he would do so. وَأَجْوَدْ بِالْخَيْرِ مِنْ رِيحِ مُرْسَلًا. And he was more generous, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and kind and benevolent than that gentle breeze that comes upon the people to relieve them of the hardship that they are going through. وَكَانَ أَجْوَدَ النَّاسِ. And he was naturally from the most generous of people. وَأَجْوَدْ مَا يَكُونَ فِي رَمَضَانٍ. And he was the most generous, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the month of Ramadan. And he would give a lot of sadaqah. He would spend much. And he was very kind and generous, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he would recite the Quran much. And he would increase in his prayer and his remembrance of Allah. Wal-i'tikaf. And he would seclude himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa kana yakhus Ramadan min al-ibadati. مَا لَا يَخُصُّ غَيْرَهُ بِهِ مِنَ الشُّهُورِ. And he will specify in this month that which he would not specify in other than it from the months. حتى إنه كان عليه الصلاة والسلام يواصل فيه أحيانا, to the extent that upon occasion, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not even break his fast. He would fast for an entire day or two, and he would do so sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he would spend all of his time in its night and its day, all of it in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the end of the speech of Ibn Qayyim. And point number six, احرص على صومك كما تحرص على حياتك. Be diligent in the preservation of your fast, the same way that you are diligent in the preservation of your life. Because it is this purpose, yarhamakallah. It was for this purpose that we were created. The reason we are alive is the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَقَدَ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةُ الْحَسَنَةِ. And certainly in the example of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we have the best of example. And it is appropriate and befitting that we emulate him sallallahu alayhi wasallam in his worship, in his prayer and in his fast, in his generosity, in his standing at night, in his recitation of Quran, and his concern for the needy and the poor, and that we should spend some time in seclusion, and that we should follow his example sallallahu alayhi wasallam, far removed from insincerity, far removed from innovation, following his teaching and his practice alone. And this is emphasized further, like he stated sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that the purpose of this month that we fast, يَتْرُكْ تَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ وَشَهْوَتَهُ مِنْ أَجَلِي, is that the servant, he abandoned food and drink and relations with his wife for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inside of this there is farha. Inside of this there is joy and there is bliss and there is happiness. That you know that you are fulfilling. That you know that you are fulfilling a rukun min arkan al-Islam. And in this regard, he states it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we find again in that hadith, لِلصَّائِمْ فَرْحَتَانْ فَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ فِتْرِي, that for the fasting person there is two happinesses that come to him. When he breaks his fast initially, and likewise, when he said فَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ فِتْرِي وَفَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ لِقَى رَبِّهِ, there is that joy and that happiness that he has when he shall meet his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Having worshipped him subhanahu, being diligent not to break his fast in any way, upon sincerity to Allah. And this is the obligatory fast between his subhana. And we know that there is a gate from the gates of Jannah, this name is Rayyan. And nobody will enter from that gate other than the people who used to fast. And it shall be, call out, where are those who used to fast? Until they come forth with this righteous good deed. And they shall be admitted into that gate from the gates of Jannah. And once they enter it, nobody shall enter that gate after them except those that fasted. And it shall be closed, bi'ithnihi subhanah. And point number eight, al-siyam yutahhir al-qulub wal-ajasam, that fasting in its nature purifies the hearts along with the bodies. Because the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal is that which took the best that is inside of a person and exemplified it, brought it out to be seen and to be known by our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though he already knows. And for this reason, he mentioned to us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the reward of the one who fasts as an encouragement. Man sama Ramadan imana wa ihtisaba, ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbih. That whoever he fasts the month of Ramadan upon iman, actively seeking the reward of Allah, all of his minor sins will be forgiven for him. And this is how the Sahaba and the Salaf were. They were diligent that nothing was able to break their fast, either from those things that break one's fast in a spiritual context, that diminish and take away from its reward, or literally from the physical things that break one's fast, like eating and drinking and relations with one's wife. So they were diligent upon this, wanting to seek this reward of Allah Azza wa Jalla to be forgiven. And it's a small price to pay in reality, that you stay away from those things that break your fast, both physically and spiritually. As for the spiritual context, then that is known. Because he stated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concerning the one who was really truly lost, that only tired himself in his worship, and he decreased and decreased and diminished from his reward, so perhaps he had no reward whatsoever. Because spiritually he invalidated his fast. And he stated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, رُبَّ صَائِمْ لَيْسَ حَظُّهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعِ وَالْعَطَسِ, that perhaps the fasting person has nothing from his fast, and obtained nothing from his fast, other than the fact that he became hungry and thirsty. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوتَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And he stated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا كَانَ صَوْمْ أَحَدِكُمْ فَلَا يَرْثَثْ وَلَا يَسْخَبْ وَإِنْ سَبَّهُ أَحَدْ أَوْ قَاتَلَهُ فَلْيَقُلْ إِنِّي صَائِمْ. And he stated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the diligence that we should have not to break our fast in the spiritual context, he said that if one of you be fasting, then let him not have relations with his wife. This is a physical invalidator of the fast. Then he said, then let him not be given in to quarreling and arguing from the spiritual things that diminish and take away from one's fast. And should he be reviled by anybody or somebody tries to fight him, let him state to that person that I am fasting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And like this, one benefits from the fast, bi'ithnihi subhanahu. And point number 9, عادات الغافلين عادة وعادات الصالحين أو الأذكياء عبادة. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala stated that the worship of the heedless ones are nothing but a common occurrence that they do and practice, a custom that they have. Why do you pray? Oh, you know, I was told to pray. Why do you fast? Because that we were told, and we were told as children to fast. They did not obtain the reason and benefit behind this tremendous act of worship. They did not realize the context of the fact that this is the purpose of your creation. Your Jannah and your Naar is upon what you spend your days in this worldly life upon and doing. They done it out of yani custom. Allahu ta'ala al-musta'an. And then he stated, وَلَعَادَاتِ الصَّالِحِينَ وَلَعَادَاتُ الصَّالِحِينَ أَوَ الْأَذْكِيَا عِبَادَةِ. As for the custom and the common practice of the righteous and those ones that were clever, then all of it is worship bi'idhnihi subhanah. And in this regard, we find in the example of our salaf, they were stated by Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala an, he said, إِنِّي أَحْتَسِبْ نَوْمَتِي كَمَا أَحْتَسِبْ قَوْمَتِي. He said, I consider my sleep at night a form of worship and seek to be rewarded by it, the same way that I understand and I seek that my being awake during the day is a form of worship. And Jabir radiallahu ta'ala an, Ibn Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he said, إِذَا سُمْتَ, if it's the case that you are to fast, he said, فَلْيَسُمْ سَمْعُكْ, then allow your ears to fast and withhold yourself back from that which is haram, from listening to the haram. He said, وَبَصَرُكَ, and likewise allow your eyes to fast if it's the case that you are to fast. Do not look at that which is haram. وَلِسَانُكَ عَنِ الْكَذِبِ وَالْمَحَارِمِ, and allow your tongue to fast from lying and from those things that are impermissible. وَدَعَذَا الْجَارِ, and give up and abandon harming your neighbors. وَلْيَكُنْ عَلَيْكَ وَقَارٌ وَسَكِينَةٌ يَوْمَ صَوْمِكَ, and make sure that when you fast that you're in a state of humility and tranquility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day that you fast. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَوْمْ صَوْمِكَ وَيَوْمْ فِطْرِكْ سَوَاءٌ, and do not allow the day that you fast and the day that you're not fasting to be the same. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوتَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And the example of how our salaf were, رضوان الله تعالى عليهم, concerning Al-Qiyam, and this is point number 10, how this salaf used to stand at night in prayer, that they were diligent upon Salatu Tarawih. They were diligent in order to pray the night prayer after Isha. And even in its name, there is an indication of how the salaf of this ummah took worship to be. They called it Tarawih, that thing that they find relaxation in, not difficulty and burden. And naturally, there is a degree of difficulty in the worship of Allah. And as Ibn Jawzi, he said, إِنَّ مَشَقَّةَ الطَّاعَةَ تَذْهَبْ وَتَبْقَى أَجَرُهُ وَثَوَابُهُ. That certainly the difficulty that is naturally found in some types of worship will eventually dissipate and go. And what will remain after that difficulty that you push yourself through, that you accustomed your nafs, that wants relaxation, that you were from those that were diligent over it and conquered it and overpowered it and reeled it in, that eventually the difficulty of that worship will go, and what will remain is this reward of Allah. وَإِنَّ لَذَّةَ الطَّاعَةَ تَذْهَبْ وَيَبْقَى عَذَابُهُ وَعِقَابُهُ. And certainly the sweetness that there is in sin, without a shadow of a doubt, leaves. And nothing remains in its place, because this dunya is faniya. This dunya will all come to an end. Nothing remains in the place of sin, other than the chastisement and the punishment that is allotted to it. As for how the Salaf were concerning this Taraweeh, this source of relaxation, then is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the worshippers of Ar-Rahman. And he stated, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنَ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا وَإِذَا خَاتَبُهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. And they are the servants of Allah, those that walk upon the earth of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in humility. They are not a haughty people. They do not reject the truth if it comes to them. They do not look down upon the creation of Allah subhanahu. And if they're addressed by the foolish, by the sinners, by the innovators, by the people of fasad, by the kuffar, by those that want to harm them and their religion, qalu salama, they say to them, making inkar. Shaykh Fawzani said to us, hafidahullah, their salam here is not that they said salamu alayk, may Allah save you from every trial and tribulation and harm in this life and the next. No, it's to say that I am free from you. That they're making inkar, they are rejecting what they're upon. And he mentioned how they are, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. And they were those that stood in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at night in prayer, in sujood and standing. And from his adab sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that he would do exactly that, that he would pray sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he did not abandon the night prayer bi'ithnihi subhanah. As Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha narrated, when she was asked concerning the prayer of the messenger, she said, لا تدع قيام الليل فَإِنَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَانَ لَا يَدَعَهُ وَكَانَ إِذَا مَرِضْ أَوْ كَسَلْ صَلَّى قَاعِدًا. And she stated, do not give up and abandon the night prayer. For our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not give up the night prayer. And had he been ill or was traveling, he would pray sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now he would pray sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sitting down. And Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, wa kana Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, yusalli min al-layl ma sha. The Umar radiallahu ta'ala an would pray from the night prayer what he desired until he would reach about half of the night. And then he would go and he would wake up his family. And this is point number 11. وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. Point number 11. Command your family to pray and be diligent and patient upon it. Allow your families to see from you an example of worship, an example of obedience, an example of taqwa, and then command them with that taqwa and that obedience and that worship. And he would recite the statement of Allah radiallahu ta'ala an in his night prayer, وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. Command your family with the prayer and be diligent and patient upon it. لا نسألك رزقا. We do not request from you that you provide for us, subhana. نحن نرزقك. We are the ones that provide for you. والعاقبة للتقوى. And the true victory is for the people of taqwa. So like this, we should be diligent in the advice to our families and our households to establish the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that if we perhaps become lazy, perhaps they would remind us and they would encourage us. And like this, one hand washes another, barakallahu feekum. And this was the guidance of our salaf, bi'ithnihi subhanah. And he compared the ones who'd done such, that they stood at night in prayer compared to those who did not. أَمَنْ هُوَ قَانِتٌ آنَاءَ اللَّيْلِ سَاجِدًا وَقَائِمًا يَحْذَرُ الْآخِرَةِ وَيَرْجُ رَحْمَةَ رَبِّهِ. Are they the same in comparison? The one who stands at night in prayer, making sujood and standing physically, fearing the hereafter and what it has from its terrors and its trials and its tribulations, whilst having balance and seeking the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it was narrated from the Salaf that they would read inside of their night prayer hundreds and hundreds of verses. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And this verse, it was said, Ibn Umar said that the verse that was mentioned here, in reality, is a mention of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an, due to how much he would pray radiallahu ta'ala an. And Ibn Abi Hatim said that Ibn Umar, he did not say this except due to the لِكَثْرَةِ صَلَاتِ أَمِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عُثْمَانَ بِاللَّيْلِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ وَقِرَاءَتِهِ حَتَّى إِذَا رُبَّمَا قَرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ فِي رَكَعَةٍ. And this was the Salaf, that this was stated by Ibn Umar to be Uthman, due to the fact that Umar, the Uthman رضي الله تعالى عنه, would pray much at night and would read so much Qur'an that perhaps he would finish the entire Qur'an in a single verse, in a single raka'ah, in a single unit of prayer. And some of them, they would hold onto a staff in order to help them and keep themselves up, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point number 12. وَلَكِنْ الصَّلَاةَ مَعَ الْإِمَامِ أَفْضَلُ. And even though this be the case, in their exaggeration in worship, or extension in worship, then to pray with the Imam until he leaves the Salah is actually better than what some of the people do, that they want to pray more, that they go and they finish early and then they go and they pray more afterwards and they did not complete with the Imam. Rather, what is better is that they finish with the Imam. فَمَنْ صَلَّ مَعَ الْإِمَامِ, like he stated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَمَنْ صَلَّ مَعَ الْإِمَامِ حَتَّى يَنْصَرِفْ قُتِبَ لَهُ قِيَامَ اللَّيْلِ. That whoever was to pray with the Imam until he leaves, it will be recorded for him as if he stood for the entire night. Number 13, حَالُ السَّلَفْ فِي الصَّدَقَةِ. The condition of the Salaf when it came to giving in charity. And without a shadow of a doubt, that the nature of Ramadan is that one becomes hungry and thirsty and his body becomes weak. That inside of this, there is a reminder for us to remember the condition of those that are needy and poor. And you have seen the effect of a small amount of dates and water, what it does to you, that you physically feel your strength coming back and you feel that joy and that happiness when you break your fast with even the most insignificant of thing that you may break your fast with. And this is a reminder of the hal, or the condition of those that are unable and the needy and the poor. From that, we should allow us to be even more generous inside of this month. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised concerning the one who was rich and the one who was poor alike, from amongst the means of a person entering into Jannah was sadaqah that he gave for the sake of Allah. And he would say sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya ayyuhan nas, ufshu salam, wat'imu al-ta'am, wasallu bil-layli. وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامْ تَدَخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ بِالسَّلَامِ. He would say, O people, spread the greeting of salam between you, that Allah saves your brother from every harm in this life and the hereafter and protects him. And feed the people from what you eat. Feed them and give them from charity, from food. And صَلُّ, and pray at night when the rest of the people are asleep. تَدَخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ, that you shall be admitted into Jannah in safety and protection. And this is how the Sahaba were, barakallahu feekum, that they were diligent concerning, yani, the condition of the poor and the needy. And it was narrated that Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, he did not eat, except that upon his table there was from the fuqara and from the yatama. Upon his table when he would eat was the poor and the orphans. And it has been narrated that one day, for whatever reason, his family had dismissed the poor and he was unable to eat with them. So he did not eat for that day and refused to eat. وَبَاتَ حَزِينَا And he spent the night saddened at what had taken place because he wanted to have that reward. And we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam كَانَ أَجْوَدَ النَّاسِ was the most generous of people. And he was the most generous sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the month of Ramadan. So give barakallahu fikum وَلَوْ بِشِقِّ التَّمَرِ Save yourselves from the fire like he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam by giving even the splitting of a date. Give that in charity sincerely for the sake of Allah. Number 14, حالهم في قراءة القرآن. And how were they concerning the reading of the Quran? The fact that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would review Quran beginning to end in the month of Ramadan, and he done so twice before his death sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn Rajab stated, وَهَذَا فِيهِ دَلِيلٌ عَلَىٰ إِسْتِحْبَابِ قِرَاءَةِ الْقُرْآنِ وَخَاتَمِهِ فِي هَذَا الشَّهْرِ الْكَرِيمِ And this indicates to us the recommendation of a person reciting the Qur'an and completing its recitation in this most blessed of month. And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an said, وَاللَّهِ لَوْ تَهَرَتِ الْقُلُوبِ If the hearts, they were to be pure, مَا شَبِعَتْ مِنْ كَلَامِ رَبِّكُمْ If the hearts were pure, they would never be full. They would never have their content and their fill of hearing the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord. وَاللَّهِ لَوْ تَهَرَتِ الْقُلُوبِ وَاللَّهِ لَوْ تَهَرَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ مَا شَبِعَتْ مِنْ كَلَامِ رَبِّكُمْ And he would swear by Allah, saying, by Allah, if the hearts were pure, they would never grow tired and never be full of hearing the speech of your Lord. So one should really reflect here and ask himself today, how much Quran did you read? This week, how much Quran did we read? This month, how much Quran did we read? In the Ramadans, yani that previously came, how much Quran did we read? And this month that is to come upon us, bi'ithnihi subhanah, how much Quran will we read? And what reminder will we obtain? And how will we spend our time? Will it be the case that we just stay on the phone all day? Or perhaps like the people they do, they spend their time watching movies or watching any series and programs, show after show, series after series. What took 10 years to finish, he spends a week watching Allahu Ta'ala al-Musta'an, wasting his time. This is the one, wallahi, who is in loss and regret be'ithnihi subhanah. And it was narrated about the Salaf, that from them are those that used to recite the Quran in completion in a single night, as was reported from Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an, and Shafi'i rahimahullah would complete the Quran 60 times in the month of Ramadan. That is twice a day. Allahu ta'ala akbar. And this does not go against the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the mention of the dislikability of one not completing the Quran in more than 3 days. And Ibn Rajab commented in this regard, وَأَنَّ هَذَا مَحْمُولٌ عَلَى غَيْرِ أَوْقَاتِ الْفَضَائِلِ وَأَوْقَاتِ الْمَوَاسِمِ الْخَيْرِ فَإِنَّهَا تُسْتَغَلُ وَقَدَ يَزِيدُ الْعَبْدُ فِي ذَلِكَ أَكْثَرْ مِنْ خَتَمِهِ فِي أَكْثَرْ مِنْ ثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامٍ And he stated, and as for the prohibition, then this should not be considered at those virtuous times and upon those occasions of goodness. Rather, they should be utilized bi'ithnihi subhanah. And the servant in reality should increase, should he have the ability to complete the Quran more than a single completion, then he should do so bi'ithnillahi ta'ala. Even so, even if it's the case that he does so in more than 3 days. Number 15, حالهم مع تدبر القرآن. How were their condition in their pondering over the Quran? Because the purpose not that it merely be recited alone, rather that the hearts begin to tremble and fear, that the heart is softened, that the athar, the effect and the thamara, the fruit of such a remembrance, of such guidance, of such light, of such a furqan, such a criterion that distinguishes between falsehood and the truth, it should be seen upon a person bi-ithnihi subhanah. And we find in the example of our messenger exactly that, as we find in Sahih Bukhari, in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, قال صلى الله عليه وسلم اقرأ علي فقال عبد الله بن مسعود أقرأ عليك وعليك أنزل. He said صلى الله عليه وسلم to Ibn Mas'ud, read the Quran to me. Ibn Mas'ud رضي الله تعالى عنه replied to him, how am I to read the Quran to you, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, when upon you it was revealed? And listen to what he said صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, إني أحب أن أسمعه من غيري. He said that I love to hear the Quran being recited by other than myself. So I love to hear the Quran, O servant of Allah. Love to recite the Quran. Love that your eyes, they fall upon the Quran in worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ibn Mas'ud, he said, فَقَرَأْتُ سُورَةَ النِّسَاءِ حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغْتُ. And he said, and I read from Surah An-Nisa until I reached the ayah. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. And how will their condition be when we bring forth from every single nation one who bears witness over them, and we bring you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, over them as a witness. فَقَالَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بِنْ مَسْعُودٍ قَالَ sallallahu alayhi wasallam حَسْبُكَ. He began to say, enough, enough. Do not read anymore. And Ibn Mas'ud, he said, فَتَلَفْتُ. I turned to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَإِذَا عَيْنَاهُ تَذْرَفَانَ. That his eyes began to swell with tears, crying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, moved. The Quran had an effect upon him, that he shall be brought forth and questioned, and he will be a witness. So what about us when we shall be witnesses over ourselves on a day that the hand will speak and the skin will speak by the permission of its Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, testifying either for us or against us. May Allah save us. And for this reason, the Salaf, they were moved by the Quran. Like the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated, La yajalu al-nar rajul بكى من خشية الله تعالى. That the fire will not burn and consume a person who cried out of fear of Allah subhanahu. And he mentions sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, عيناني لا تمسهما النار عين بكت من خشية الله. That there are two eyes that will not be burnt by the fire, meaning the companion of those eyes. And from them are the eye, are those eyes that cried out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look at the example of that day when we return to him subhanahu. And he stated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, سَبْعَ يُذِلُّهُمَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فِي ذِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ذِلَّ إِلَّا ذِلُّهُ رَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. On that day they shall be granted shade, when there is no shade other than the shade of Allah subhanahu. And from them was a person, a man who in seclusion began to cry out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it was said about Ibn Umar, he read from Surah Al-Mutaffifin until he reached the statement of Allah, يَوْمَ تَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And that day when mankind shall be forth, standing in front of the Lord of everything that exists. And he began to cry so profusely that he could no longer stand in his salah anymore. And he could no longer recite. And it was reported from Mazahim ibn Zahr, radiallahu ta'ala an. He said, Salla bina Sufyan al-Thawr al-Maghrib, hatta balagha iyaka na'abuda wa iyaka nasta'in. The Sufyan ibn Thawr radiallahu ta'ala, he led them in salatul Maghrib. until he came to the statement of Allah, you alone we worship and you alone we ask for help. وَبَكَى حَتَّى انْقَطَعَتْ قِرَاءَتُهُ. And he began to cry and cry and cry until he was unable to recite anymore. And then he had to go back and he recited يعني the surah from the beginning. And it was narrated عن إبراهيم بن أشعث قال سمعت فضيلا يقول ذات ليلة وهو يقرأ سورة محمد وهو يبكي ويردد هذه الآية. He said, I heard Fudayl reading one night, repeating from Surah Muhammad while he's crying. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ حَتَّى نَعْلَمَ الْمُجَاهِدِينَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَنَبْلُوَ أَخْبَارَكُمْ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test us, that He will test you. حَتَّى نَعْلَمْ, until He makes known subhanahu wa ta'ala who were those that strove in His cause and sake subhanahu, and who were from the patients, from those that were patient. وَنَبْلُوَ أَخْبَارَكُمْ. And we will test this statement that you say, that you believe. We will see how much you say you believe. Or one who says he believes in the Jannah, work for it. Or one who says that he believes in the fire, run from it. And he will test us, subhanah. And he said, وَجَعَلَ يَبْكِي رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ. And he began to cry, saying, وَنَبَلُوا أَخْبَارَكُمْ. And if Allah was to test our sincerity, and He would repeat this, and He said, certainly if you have tested us, إِن بَلَوْتَ أَخْبَارَنَا فَدَحْتَنَا, that should we be brought to account in such regard, then indeed we shall be disgraced. If He was to test us right now, without returning back to Him, subhanah, هَتَكْتَ أَسْتَارَنَا, and you have torn our covering, O Allah subhanak. إِنَّكَ إِذَا بَلَوْتَ أَخْبَارَنَا أَهْلَكْتَنَا وَعَذَبْتَنَا. And should you bring us to account at this moment in time, perhaps we will be from those that are punished and destroyed. And he would cry, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. And the Salaf did not shy away from admitting to their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala their shortcoming and sin. And they would use these occasions of worship, the month of Ramadan and other than it, in order to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point number 16. حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبَلَ الْحِسَابِ. Bring yourselves to account before accountability comes. So look, O servant of Allah, how much shortcoming we have fallen into in the right of Allah, in the right of His creation. May Allah pardon us. And may we rectify that which is between us and them, and that which is between us and our Lord. And look how much sin that we have fallen into, and how far and distant we are from Allah. And if you want to see yourself and the reality of your worship, and the reality of what is in your heart, look at two things. How you are in seclusion, and what is upon the tip of your tongue. And if that contained the mercy of Allah, and His taqwa, then thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and beg Him that you may remain as such. And if it's the case that it's not, and upon the end of your tongue is not the remembrance of Allah, and it's not His worship, and it's not commanding the good and forbidding the evil, rather there is nothing but evil and commanding with sin and transgression, then return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Open up a new page. Start a new day, bi'ithnihi subhanah. Turn over a new leaf, as they say, upon this occasion that has come to us, and use every single moment of it to worship Him subhanah. Number 18, 17. يَنزِلُ كُلُّ لَيْلَةٍ الْغَنِي الْحَمِيد. The dead descends every single night. He subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is not in need of anything from His creation, the one that is deserving of praise subhanah. So we know that Allah, as appears in the authentic hadith of the Messenger, descends in a manner befitting His majesty, subhanah, and glory and perfection. Nothing like His creation. He descends to the lowest level of the heavens every night, asking, calling out to the servants, who of you ask of me that I may give him? Who of you calls upon me that I may respond? Who seeks my forgiveness that I may forgive him? And He does all of that. Whilst He is al-ghani, whilst He's the one that is not in need of us, but we're in need of Him, subhanah. And he stretches out his hand, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the servants. وَيَتُوبُ لِيَتُوبُ عَلَيْنَا مُسِيءَ النَّهَارِ, that in order that he may forgive and pardon the one who sinned during the day. And he stretches out his arms, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to accept the repentance of the one that sinned during the night. And know that Allah Azza wa Jalla is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, that he is the most merciful, subhanah, the most benevolent, Jalla Jalalu. And at the same time, he's Shadidul Iqab, he's the most severe in punishment. So be like those whom he describes, subhanahu wa ta'ala, inside of this month and outside of it. When he described the true believers, he stated about them, تَتَجَافَ جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَضَاجِعِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, that they were those that forsake their beds at night, calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in prayer, in hope and fear, in hope of His mercy, but having balance, whilst being fearful of His punishment, subhanahu. And especially in these nights, bi'ithnillahi subhanahu, and especially when it comes to Laylatul Qadr, which we shall discuss, bi'ithnillahi subhanahu. And point number 19 is the hal of the Salaf in the last 10 days. And it was stated from that which is an encouragement for us to increase in our efforts. كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل العشر شد مئزرة وأحيا ليلة وأيقظ أهله. That in the last 10 days, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he would tighten his belt, you could say, and he would spend the whole night in prayer, and he would wake up his family for it. So do not be like those, barakallahu feekum, that they miss the opportunity to stand in every single night from the nights of Ramadan, and especially in the last 10 days. Because in reality, these occasions are almost like yani istidrak from Allah Azza wa Jal, that He almost gives us these opportunities to make up for our shortcoming. The Ramadan is almost given to make up for what has preceded him throughout the whole entire year. And from the guidance of the Salaf, is to seek out the last 10 days and to be diligent in them in worship, and to seek out within those 10 days in its nights, Laylatul Qadr. And every single one of them, bi'ithnillah ta'ala, reinforces the other. For the one that spent perhaps the beginning of the month in that which was not appropriate, or did not strive how he should have strove, he has the last 10 days to really literally tie his belt and to strive that perhaps that will be that which overlooks that which preceded. And if he was felt short in these 10 days, he has the nights where he looks for Laylatul Qadr. And the Salaf concerning the Salah, they would make ghusl, and of course wudu, ويتطيبون, and they would put طيب upon themselves, the best smelling of perfume that they had, and they would cleanse themselves and clean themselves, and they would go and they would pray at night. And like this, Allah Azza wa Jalla had mercy upon us. And in reality, the one that is prevented from seeing or from meeting Laylatul Qadr, like he stated, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, حُرِّمَ الْخَيْنِ كُلَّهِ, then he has been prevented and prohibited from every goodness. And look at the example of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she was asked as to what she would say. Then she said, I said what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say. Allahumma inni innaka afu tuhibbu al-afwa fa'afu anna. Allahumma innaka afu tuhibbu al-afwa fa'afu anna. That you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these nights, oh Allah, indeed you are the one who pardons and you love to pardon, so pardon us. And to repeat this bi'ithnihi subhanah throughout the Ramadan, and especially in the last 10 days, bi'ithnihi subhanah. And we know without a shadow of a doubt that the Ramadan is as such, there should be a means of ithbat wa istimrar ala ta'ah. And this is our final point, point number 20, bi'ithnihi subhanah. Let Ramadan be that boost, that which makes you firm and allows you to continue upon that goodness. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam صعد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المنبر، رقى درجة فقال آمين، ثم رقى درجة أخرى فقال آمين، ثم رقى درجة ثالثة فقال آمين. فسأله الصحابة رضي الله ترى عنهم: أنت أميني؟ He ascended the minbar sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one day, and on the first step he said Ameen, and took a second step and said Ameen, and took a third and final step and said Ameen. And the Sahaba asked him, what was it that caused him to say Ameen? And he stated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Atani Jibreel anifa faqala raghima anfu imri'in dhukirtu indahu فَلَمْ يُصَلِّ عَلَيَّا. That may he who hears of me and does not send salah upon me, عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاةُ وَأَتَمُّ التَّسْلِيمُ, then let he be debased and disgraced. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوتَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على نبينا محمد. And he said وَرَغِمَ. Oh, then he said, and then I said آمين. And then he stated وَرَغِمَ أَنْفُ إِمْرِئٍ أَدْرَكَ وَالِدَيْهِ فَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. Then may he be debased and disgraced, the one who has his parents reach an old age and he was not forgiven by being dutiful to them. And then he stated, saying Ameen. And all of this is from the means of righteousness to the creation, which in reality is nearness to Allah. And he said, finally, وَرَغِمَ أَنْفْ إِمْرِئٍ أَدْرَكَ رَمَضَانٍ فَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. And may he be debased and disgraced, the one who reached Ramadan and he was not forgiven for his sins. Oh Allahi, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to be from those that fast Ramadan, إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا, and in true faith, and seeking actively his reward, and that he allows us to be from those that stand in its nights, إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا, in true faith, actively seeking his reward. And Ibn Rajab rahimahullah ta'ala, he stated some nice lines of poetry, and he stated, يَا ذَا الَّذِي مَنْ مَا كَفَاهُ الذُّنُوبِ فِي رَجَبْ حَتَّى عَصَى رَبَّهُ فِي شَهْرِ شَعْبَانِ. That, O you who was not sufficed by sinning throughout the month of Rajab, until he decided to sin even in the month that came after it, the month before Ramadan, the month of Sha'ban. لَقَدْ أَظَلَّكَ شَهْرُ صَوْمٍ بَعْدَهُمَا فَلَا تُسْهِرُهُمَا أَيْضًا شَهْرُ الْعِسْيَانِ. And there has come upon you the month of fasting, so do not be like how you were with the 2 months previously, from those that did not hold themselves back, and you make this month likewise a month of sin. وَاتْلُوا الْقُرْآنَ وَسَبِّحْ فِيهِ مُجْتَهِدًا فَإِنَّهُ شَهْرُ التَّسْبِيحِ وَالْقُرْآنِ. For indeed, recite the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and glorify Him much and strive in that regard. For this is certainly the month of glorifying Allah and the month of the Qur'an. وَحْمِنْ عَلَى جَسَدِ تَرْجُوا النَّجَاةَ لَهُ فَسَوْفَ تُدْرَمْ أَجَسَادُ بِنِيرَانِ. And preserve your body from that which is from sin and transgression, that you hope that it be preserved. For certainly the bodies will be burned and consumed by the fire. كَمْ كُنْتَ تَعْرِفْ مِمَّنْ صَامَ فِي سَلَفٍ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَهْلِ وَجِيرَانِ وَإِخْوَانِ. And how many of your companions do you know from those that have gone and they have passed away now, who were with us previously, between their household and their friends and their neighbors and their brothers. أَفْنَاهُمُ الْمَوْتِ وَاسْتَقْبَلَكَ بَعْدَهُمْ حَيًّا فَمَا أَقْرَبُ الْقَاسِ مِنَ الدَّانِ. And they were only taken away by death itself, and now it stands here looking at you in the face after them, whilst you are alive and you are not far from their example. وَمُعَجَّبٍ بِثَوْبِ الْعِيدِ يَقْتَعُهَا فَأَصْبَحَتْ فِي غَدِ الْأَثْوَابِ أَكْفَانِ. And the one that previously was preparing, had many, many plans he did, went and had his Eid thawb cut and made from cloth, Little did he know it was the same material that would be used to shroud him upon his death. حتى متى يعمر الإنسان مسكنه مصير مسكنه قبر الإنسان. And how long will a man be deluded by this worldly life that he lives in, thinking that it is his final abode, when in reality the only abode that we are to live in reality is nothing other than the grave that we are placed in. وهذا والله تعالى أعلم وصلي اللهم وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين.